Penguin Random House Audio presents Betrayal, the Final Act of the Trump Show. This is the author, Jonathan Karl. This book is dedicated to my mom, the kindest person on the planet.
What he should have done is sent him back.
Were you worried about him during that siege? Were you worried about
his
safety?
No, I thought he was well protected, and I had heard that he was in good shape.
Mm-hmm.
No, because I had heard he was in very good shape. But no,
you heard those chants. That was terrible. I mean, those, you know, the...
He could have... Well, the people were very angry.
They're saying, hang my
Because pants. It's common sense, John. It's common sense.
The interview, I was told, would happen right there in the middle of the lobby, a room with two enormous crystal chandeliers hanging from a towering gold ceiling, the ornate and glittering space that once served as the living room for Marjorie Meriwether Post, the heiress who built the place. Before long, Donald Trump arrived, wearing a suit and a tie. He ordered a Diet Coke and got right down to business, not waiting for my questions. You know, we are putting out releases, he said. These releases are much more elegant than Twitter. We are really getting the word out. The former leader of the free world, who had been banned by Twitter and every other major social media platform for spreading disinformation, had discovered a more effective way of communicating, the press release. As the interview went on, members of Trump's Mar-a-Lago Club began to arrive for drinks and dinner on the patio outside, each one of them passing right by us, each one of them seeing him being interviewed. He could have talked to me in a private area of the club, but why would he do that? He wanted everybody to see him being interviewed, out of office, but still the center of attention. Over the next 90 minutes, I asked him about some of the darkest moments in the history of American democracy, when, for the first time, an American president refused to concede defeat, attempted to turn over an election, and inspired his most diehard supporters to stop the peaceful transfer of power. As you will see later in this book, his words were chilling, but his demeanor cheerful. In his gilded exile, he feels abused and betrayed, convinced the darkest betrayals came from those closest to him. But in our conversation, as Donald Trump lashes out at enemies real and perceived, he seems happy, joyful, joyfully aggrieved. He's plotting a new campaign, not necessarily a political comeback, that's far-fetched, although not impossible, but a campaign to make his erstwhile friends and allies pay a price for their betrayal. All the talk of disloyalty and revenge made him so gleeful, he asked me to stick around for dinner. As I headed to the dining area outside, Trump went elsewhere, another meeting, he told me. The main patio of Mar-a-Lago overlooks the club's pool, and beyond that, the lagoon that separates Palm Beach from the Florida mainland. It's a beautiful place, half enclosed by the curved colonnade that extends from the part of the club where Trump has his private residence to the areas open to club members. As the sun went down, the tables began to fill with diners, a mostly older and enormously wealthy crowd. On this night, there were about 100 people spread out over a few dozen tables. Shortly after I began eating, I heard a few people begin clapping. The clapping, isolated at first, soon spread across the patio, turning into sustained applause. As everyone soon noticed, Donald Trump was making his way from his residence. The diners were then on their feet, giving a standing ovation for the former president as he slowly walked down the Mar-a-Lago colonnade, a structure reminiscent of the line of pillars outside the Oval Office and alongside the Rose Garden. The ovation continued until he got to the archway leading to the living room where I had interviewed him. He pointed to a few of the guests. He waved and pumped his fist and then made his way to a table just like the others, although this table had a small velvet rope around it. The applause continued until Trump took his seat. As the guests returned to their dinners, I asked one of the members how often this happens. How often does the former president stroll along the colonnade on his way to dinner as members of his club rise to their feet in rapturous applause? Every night, he told me. Every night. Introduction. One of the first calls I made as I watched the rioters move toward the Capitol building on January 6, 2021, was to John Kelly, the retired four-star Marine general who previously had served as President Trump's first chief of staff. More than a year before the 2020 election, as I was finishing front row at the Trump show, I had asked Kelly what would happen if Trump lost the election and refused to concede. Back then, the question was a hypothetical one, but it was one I had been thinking about for a long time. What if Trump tried to stay in the White House? How would this all end? Oh, he'll leave, Kelly told me back then, and if he refuses to leave, there are people who will escort him out. As chief of staff, Kelly had seen firsthand how Trump operates, and he knew how the White House really functions. Clearly, he had thought about this before and had played out the scenario in his mind. If he tried to chain himself to the Resolute, Kelly told me, referring to the enormous desk in the Oval Office, they would simply cut the chains and carry him out. Kelly has a deep and commanding voice befitting a retired four-star Marine general. He said these words with authority, as if he was speaking an immutable truth that needed no further discussion. To Kelly, it wasn't complicated. If Trump loses, he'll be gone at noon on January 20th, 2021. That's what the Constitution dictates. It's as simple as that. I didn't ask any more questions, but I still had a few. Who would escort him out? Who would cut the chains? Who were they? Would it be the Secret Service? Would it be the Marine who stands sentry at the entrance of the West Wing? The image Kelly described was a crazy one, a defeated president getting dragged from the White House while he refuses to admit defeat. Since John Adams lost re-election to Thomas Jefferson in 1800, every defeated president has accepted the results and voluntarily left office. The scenario described by John Kelly seemed too disturbing and too absurd to consider any further. I tried not to think about it again. By January 6, the question was no longer hypothetical. Trump wasn't due to leave the White House for two more weeks, but for nearly 2 months he had been denying the results of the election, and now his supporters were storming the Capitol and trying to stop the certification of Joe Biden's victory. I broke off from ABC's live coverage of the terrifying scene unfolding on Capitol Hill, and I called Kelly. "This isn't America," he told me. Like any rational person in America, he was angry about what was happening, and he was clear that the man he had served as chief of staff was to blame. If he was a real man, he would go down to the Capitol and tell them to stop, he said, telling me that it was time for the Trump cabinet to step in to save the country by declaring Trump mentally unfit and removing him from office. If I was still there, I would call the cabinet and start talking about the 25th Amendment, he told me. Invoking the 25th Amendment and getting a majority of the cabinet to agree the president is unfit for office is the equivalent of cutting the chains and forcibly escorting the president from the Oval Office. There would be more talk of the 25th Amendment that night and over the coming days, but the first mention of it I had heard on January 6th was from Donald Trump's former chief of staff, while the rioters were still inside the Capitol building. Kelly's views were shared by many who had supported and served Trump, and by more than a few who were still serving in positions of authority in his administration. I spoke to people close to Trump during the final days and weeks in office who told me they thought Trump was mentally unstable, that he had literally gone mad. Members of his cabinet began talking about invoking the 25th Amendment during the evening of January 6th. They may not acknowledge this fact publicly while Trump is still a political force, but they were. Lawyers were asked to quietly look into whether the 25th Amendment made it possible for the cabinet to remove Trump from office under the current circumstances, and whether such an action would survive legal challenge. When the 25th Amendment option was deemed unworkable, there were several unanswered questions, including whether all the acting secretaries in Trump's cabinet would have a vote, a couple of cabinet secretaries resigned. Others made a pact among themselves to keep the president they served from doing more damage to the country. Even as I wrote this book, attempts to whitewash the history of Trump's final days in office had begun. There are those who say Trump didn't really want his supporters to storm the Capitol or to violently disrupt the certification of the election results. Although, as you will see later in this book, Trump himself made it clear to me that he looks back on January 6th fondly, and he believes that if the events had just played out a little differently, he'd still be president. There are also those who say the violence that day has been exaggerated, that there was no real threat to our democracy, that it was just a protest that got a little out of hand. That's a lie. January 6th was an attempt to overturn a presidential election. It was an assault on democracy itself. I knew that on January 6th. We all did. But the more I learned about the events leading up to that day, the more disturbing the story became. Over the course of my research and reporting for this book, I spoke to many of Donald Trump's top advisors and closest confidants, and several members of his cabinet. Many of those conversations came in the days before and during January 6th. Others spoke to me after it was all over. The more I learned, the more I became convinced that as horrific as January 6th seemed, as the events unfolded, our nation was far more imperiled than most of us realized at the time. It's something of a miracle that nothing worse happened between the time Donald Trump lost the election in November and when he finally left office in January. You will hear in these pages that America was dangerously close to being led into a foreign war at least twice after the election by a president who was flirting with war at home. The seeds of our potential peril were sown in early 2020. As a deadly new virus was spreading across Asia, Donald Trump embarked on two campaigns. The first was a re-election campaign designed to win by dividing the country and, if that failed, to undermine the results. The second campaign, largely invisible to the public, was a campaign to root out disloyalists in the federal government, to seek out and remove anyone in the Trump administration deemed insufficiently loyal to Donald Trump. If there had been anyone around Trump who stopped him from acting on his most destructive tendencies during the first 3 years of his presidency, they were either purged or sidelined by the end. By January 2021, hardly anyone was left to challenge him, to tell him no. One of the striking things about January 6th is how many of the most senior members of the Trump administration were missing in action as the Capitol was ransacked and the president failed to do anything to stop it. As things went so desperately wrong, most of the people left in the Trump administration who had the standing to confront Trump were running in the other direction. One cabinet secretary was in Qatar. Another was in Khartoum on his way to Israel. The national security advisor was in Florida. Trump's son-in-law and senior advisor Jared Kushner was on a government charter flight returning from Riyadh, Saudi Arabia. There is no evidence any of those people even bothered to speak to the president by phone on January 6th or urged him to condemn the rioters. Most of them didn't even bring it up with him in the days after the attack. They were either afraid to confront the president they served or convinced it wouldn't do any good if they had tried. My first book on the Trump presidency, written before the disastrous events of 2020, explored the dilemma facing a journalist reporting on a president who had declared war on journalism, calling real news fake and a free press the enemy of the people. Donald Trump branded reporters and mainstream news organizations as the opposition party. He did that to undermine our credibility, to make it possible for him to dismiss negative stories as nothing more than attacks from his political opponents. I wrote in my first book that reporters sometimes played right into the trap set by Trump. All too often, I wrote, reporters and news organizations have aided and abetted the effort to undermine the free press by openly displaying how much they detest this president, his policies, his blatant disregard for the truth, or his vilification of the press, and behaving like anti-Trump partisans rather than journalists striving for fairness and objectivity. We are not the opposition party, but that is the way some of us have acted. Even through the events of 2020, the reckless and dishonest handling of the pandemic, the relentless politicization of everything at the White House, and the shameful and destructive lies that followed the election defeat, I tried to treat Trump fairly. I have never wavered from my belief that journalists are not the opposition party and should not act like we are. But the first obligation of a journalist is to pursue truth and accuracy. And the simple truth about the last year of the Trump presidency is that his lies turned deadly and shook the foundations of our democracy. That is the truth. And if that makes me sound like a member of the opposition party, so be it. The darkness of this time is not diminished by acknowledging that in 2020, we also saw that...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.